Cooper Webb, and I choose OGIO.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Dean Wilson.
I'm Aaron Plessinger.
I'm Jerry Martin.
I'm Nate Thrasher.
I'm Shane McGrath.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
My name's Jet Lawrence.
I'm Jordan Smith.
I'm Tal Hawkins.
Stargate Hampshire.
I'm Hayden Deegan.
I'm Colt Nichols.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Tom Diala. I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I'm Jiren Ferrangis.
And I choose OGIO.
All new Yamaha YZ450F. Narrower, more compact, and lighter. Built to do one thing, go faster.
Hey everyone, welcome to the SML show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Don Maeda, joined again by my good friend Jeremy McGrath. Thank you for coming on today and joining us on our new set. We just celebrated our third anniversary of Swapmoto Live. And, you know, I said it in some of the things I wrote on that day, but man, on behalf of myself, Chase, Anton, Donnie, and Dom, we're like, we cannot thank you enough for everything you've done for us. So.
Oh, no worries. Yeah, you know, it's always exciting to, I mean, proud of you guys. 3 years.
Yeah.
Look at this. It's a little, quite a step up from the little JM2 shop, but we had it going on for a little while there.
Oh, so. Dude, it was a dream come true, man.
And it was kind of a, you know, I know, it was a floating studio for you guys, really, because I had all my junk in there. But anyway, it worked out for what it was. I'm stoked for you guys. Oh, this place is sweet.
Yeah. You know, I can't, it escapes me right now who it was I was speaking to, but it was someone from a business, and they're all, hey, I met Jeremy for the first time, and he just kept talking about what a first-class person you are. Like, oh, he did this, and he didn't have to be this nice to my clients and this, but I was just like, that's just Jeremy. That's the Jeremy I've known my whole life, and When Transworld's rug was pulled out from beneath us, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Donnie Wilson and I were just spinning. We were in a tailspin. We didn't know what we were doing. And
yeah, we had a lot of late night conversations about that one.
Yeah, but that's when Donnie called me at the San Diego Supercross. It's like, hey, come watch the race in Jeremy's suite. And the thing that stuck with me was like, you grabbed me and you're like, dude, buy it back.
Yeah.
You know, try to buy it back. How much is it going to cost? And you're like, you know what, $1 million? That's a house payment. You could do that. Don't you believe in yourself? But but the sentence you said that struck me was business is only scary because you haven't done it yet.
Yeah, I mean, it's that's all business, right? I mean, you're really nervous of the roads you haven't taken.
Mm-hmm.
It's like when you get off your phone and you go like, man, I don't have the map up. Where am I at?
Yeah,
you know, you're going somewhere. It's I think we were a little more used to that when in the old days when we were a little bit younger and we didn't have all this technology and we just had to go on road trips and do all this stuff and break out the Thomas Brothers map and all this stuff. You know, I think a business is a little bit like that. And Donnie and I were talking about when that happened with Transworld. It was like, well, my natural instinct was, well, like, if they're not doing nothing, well, let's go get it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think, you know, it was a shocking move for you guys.
Yeah. Yeah.
Really, right? I mean, you're like, okay, what do we do now? But the good thing you have is you know how to do your business. And so that's the good part.
I don't know. But, you know, aside from thanking you for the inspiration and encouragement, I mean, you gave us a home for our first 3 years. So first at the truck shop in Elsinore, right?
Yeah, first there. And then when things were hot, I got rid of the building and we moved over to the old McGrath Auto Shop. And it was, I'd say, a little step down from what we were doing over there. But, you know, for the most part, I it's just how things were working out in my life, right? Like, I wasn't – Lucas Oil Truck Series kind of went away. I didn't need a shop over there. That's what I bought it for. The investment was good. Time to sell.
Yeah.
And so I kind of – you know, I might have, like, pulled the rug out from under you a little bit too. But
no,
it was only a partial way.
Yeah.
At least we went somewhere else.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Well, I remember when you told me you were selling the building, I was like, hey, man, thank you for everything. And you're like, oh, no, you're coming with us. And
I'm like,
Really?
Well, we had to do some remodeling and all that, but it worked out good. It was cool. It was a fun shop. I think, you know, when you have a bikes and side-by-sides and mountain bikes and all kinds of stuff around, and you can create some fun. So
yeah, we did that. Yeah, for sure. I think you still need to get your pump track going in the backyard there. We'll come back.
Yeah, I do. I definitely do. I just, you know, it's hard to find the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so earlier today, I saw you at Kewea Creek Motocross.
Yeah.
And you went by and you saw me with my camera in the middle and you're all, woo! So, I mean, obviously, dirt bikes still bring a smile to your face. You still love riding moto.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. We've been getting a lot of weather out here on the West Coast for a long time. And I really have been thinking about my dirt bike for a while. And it's just like, oh, man, it's either been too muddy or, I don't know, like stuff was closed because we had so much rain. So, which is a good thing. I mean, we need the water out here, of course. But, so yeah, I just been jonesing to ride my dirt bike. And today I went out at Kahia Creek, and which is my favorite track around. Mm-hmm. And, it's just so fun. You know, the Wednesday vibe there is super cool. Saw a lot of friendly faces, a lot of friends. Mm-hmm. And yeah, when I saw you, I was like, oh yeah, give you the what's up. So, I enjoyed it. You know, it's funny. I had to force myself to not ride too much today because I really wanted to keep riding. But I mean, seriously, like today's Wednesday. Friday, I will not be able to walk if I just kept riding. Mm. So I wanted to like this is my first time back like in 2 months probably.
Yeah.
And I was pretty excited. I think it went pretty well. Got my bike dialed in really nice. So looking forward to the next one.
When you say you'd be sore on Friday, is it the knee replacement?
No, my knee's fine. It's just my rickety old body. Just from like trying to go fast and riding too many laps and trying to just be more than I actually am at the moment. So anyway, I'm just, I had a nice medium ride, did 3 motos and I think I'll be good.
Yeah. At this point in your life, is riding as exhilarating and satisfying as it used to be, or is it more so because you don't get to do it as often?
You know, I think it's equally as fun. It's equally as satisfying. You know, I get bummed because I just can't go quite as fast as I used to.
But is it?
But I'm okay with that. I mean, I'm okay.
But when you
it.
Say you can't go as fast, is it because you're like, oh, I'm older now and I shouldn't do this? Or is it?
No. I mean, I've always had a pretty good, like, sort of limiter, right? You know, like, even when I was, like, at my fastest speed ever, I still had a limiter of, like, not to try to throw myself on the ground, you know? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, today, more like today's riding is just like I needed to warm up into it. Like, mm-hmm. I feel like if I get some consistency, I can ride pretty decent. But, you know, like I felt kind of fish out of water until like even third moto today. And I was just tuning the suspension on my bike and just working on it a little bit. And the last moto was really, really fun. So that got me really pumped for like the next session I'm going to do. It's not going to be 2 months, I can tell you that. Yeah. Maybe next week. So.
Yeah, well, you've probably got some Maxxis testing coming up, right? They got a new tire.
We do. I talked to Chris actually recently, and there is a new tire, so we're going to be doing some of that. I don't think we've set a date yet, but
yeah, I know there was a save the date floating around and a couple of track names, but looking forward to that for sure.
Yeah, hopefully we can do it before it gets too hot.
Yeah.
It's nice out.
We have the weather like we've been having, right?
Yeah.
Does the old racer in you still think hills? Want to go to the hills?
Well, you know, we did a Troy Lee shoot about
GP Pro stuff.
Yeah, we did a Troy Lee shoot a month ago? Mm-hmm. Maybe it was 2 months ago now. Yeah. I don't know. I haven't ridden in 2 months. Maybe I rode that day, but that before that, it was 5 weeks ago. And we went in the hills and we brought shovels and we like carved up some cliffs and stuff. And it was really, really fun. I hadn't done that in years. I mean, even like back before I retired from racing, I hadn't really done that. So since the 90s, really. And it brought back a lot of memories. Yeah, I mean, I drive around thinking about hills and jumps, and I still do that. Like when it's raining and then you see like, oh man, that washout really nice. Oh, that'd make a nice lip.
Yeah.
You know, or like that's what I do. I drive around and look at stuff and go like, would I jump that? Maybe.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know. It's just built in. I can't stop.
Has it converted to drive around thinking I could go up that in my Terex?
Or is it still everything is still dirt bike mind.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we do a lot of fun stuff in the Terex. We do a lot of racing and a lot of desert trips. My girls love it. We all love it. We do it as a family, and we're having so much fun in those things. and they're unstoppable. They're amazing. But when I'm riding around in my car, I'm looking at jumps, and those things, I don't really look at things like jumps. I look at more like rocks. Would I climb that? Mm-hmm. Could I get over that? You know, those are the challenges I look at when I'm thinking side-by-side stuff, but mostly it's a dirt bike mind still.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Once a dirt biker, always a dirt biker.
I think so. You know, I think so. And yeah, I get a lot of that. I think dirt bikes and bicycles, really, still. So.
All right, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. Back for more. Everyone, welcome back to the SML show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. I'm here with Jeremy. Dude, so you are still very involved and in touch with the racing these days because you're doing the Science of Supercross and stuff. But like the racing this year has been really exciting, I think.
I would say, yeah. I mean, I'm involved because I love it. Right? Yeah. Let's just start with that because I'm still passionate about it. Glued to the TV every weekend if I'm not there.
Yeah.
But yeah, the racing's been exciting.
Really good.
I mean, I sit home and I get frustrated by watching some of these guys. I'm like, how are they not stepping it up? Yeah. Or like, how is he crashing again? Or like, it's the funniest thing. I mean, I'm critique all that stuff when I'm watching, but it's been very fun to watch. Very entertaining.
Yeah. Okay, so the big thing last year was like the new chassis on the KTM and Husky, and the guys are struggling with it, and then seems like they figured some stuff out this year. That reminded me of the whole famous thing about you riding the 93 chassis for a few years. Did the chassis change in 94 and you didn't like it, so you said I want to stay on this frame?
Yeah, the way it worked with you know, now that I'm older, I'm a firm believer that, like, you know, when you grow up on something and you just ride it, it just, like, becomes your favorite thing. And it just is, whatever that is, you're just still learning and that's what you really like. You know, and you're right. Watching Supercross this year, like, Webb's been much better, I think, and Plessinger. So, I mean, these guys are riding the bikes quite a bit better, those brands. but, yeah, back in the day, the chassis was good, right? So 93, 94, 95, 96 chassis were all steel. The 93 chassis had a little bit different engine position, and it just seemed to get better starts. So if you remember the 94 season, I had some really fun races in the very beginning of the season because I wasn't getting the hole shots. I was getting decent medium starts, but like the one race in particular that stands out was like Anaheim, where I just took me 10 laps to catch Larry Ward. He was you know, I got a really bad start that night. So
was that a 94 chassis?
That was a 94 chassis. And so every year we gave it like a valiant effort of trying to like ride the most current stuff. but you know, pretty much after 94, we tried the 95, but we would never really race with it. That year we raced with the new stuff, and then the next years we would test, and then we'd practice starts and do all this stuff, and then we'd race in Europe, and it was like, ah, I like my old bike, and I would just ride my old bike. Yeah. It was updated with all the new parts, so it was a brand new bike, but geometry was the older style.
Yeah. So that being said, is it?
And that went all the way through 96.
Yeah.
So the year that I won all the races was the same chassis I won my first race on.
On the old shoe.
Yeah, exactly. But it had a way better engine, and you know, that bike, the 96 bike, was pretty incredible. So it had updated everything at that time. Mm-hmm. But you know, we tested and tried the new stuff all the time. I'm not sure, like, whether Lamson was riding new or old or whatever, he was always on different clamps and forks and different things than I was. Once I, you know, figured out what I liked, I'm like, that's good. I got to figure it out from here. You don't need to change anything else. We're good. So that sort of worked. And now motocross was a different story, right? So we'd go to we'd try all kinds of different stuff. And, you know, it's well documented that, you know, 93, I was, 93, I rode 125 outdoor. 94, I rode 250 outdoor. But, you know, I wasn't really disciplined enough. I wasn't focused enough to really set my bike up and all that. I just live for supercross. That's it. Mm-hmm. I'll get third and fourth in outdoor, and that's fine with me. I'm cool with it. Until everyone just started talking about how, you know, I'd never be regarded as one of the greatest riders ever because I can't ride motocross and all this stuff. Even though I was finishing third.
Yeah.
But, you know, I kind of set myself up for that because I was winning so much in supercross. So, yeah, we had a lot of fun years. You know, the benefits back then for what Honda was doing, and it's probably still the same today. I don't know who has what, whatever. But, man, we had so many test parts. I mean, it was so fun because we had so many parts that nobody could get, and we just had 50 of them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it was all stuff that nobody could get. So when you're young, that stuff means a lot. You're like, it's pretty unique, of course, but it also feels pretty special. Because you know you're not riding just a standard bike, you know? And, you know, I think the CRs back then, standard bike was pretty awesome. Mm-hmm. You know, I raced one of those in Europe a lot and won a lot of races on it. Just standard bike, suspension, and bars.
When you were testing to try to make the newer bikes work and would go back to 93, would you try like parts that would kind of blow your mind that would make a difference, like different diameter engine?
Yeah, I mean, we didn't... you know, with the four strokes, the engine hangers, and there was different things. You know, on two strokes, it didn't make that much difference with engine hangers. Engine position made some changes, of course. There was different hangers that would switch around the position of stuff. I guess in a way, I'm kind of lucky that I, you know, stumbled across something that I love so much, right? So a lot of times everyone's searching. And, you know, it was like a light went off when my bike just kind of got sorted out. And same thing years later in motocross when I got like a 94. End of 94, put my head down and came out for 95 season, was strong and won the outdoor series. My bike was incredible that year. I mean, I actually loved riding outdoor because my bike was working so good. And like, I was disciplined enough to go out there and ride it in the bumps. And, so yeah, there was a lot of real neat stuff that, you know, when you're not involved with a factory team, you just don't know any of that stuff's going on. But I think, you know, now the production bikes are so good. There's stuff they do, but, you know, certainly with a 450, it can be too fast.
Yeah.
Right. So I think it's all like tuning and stuff like that. So yeah, it's a different world, I think, today as it was than I was racing. We had a lot more, say, exploratory times, I think, you know. Now it's probably just too expensive to be doing all that stuff all the time.
Yeah.
So it was fun though. That was really cool. I can't even imagine it was what it was like when it was, you know, Johnny, David, Ricky, you know, back in the day with the Honda team, and they were on works bikes. I mean, they must have had so much fun having all those parts.
Yeah.
That was cool. So, yeah, I still think the 90s was a good time to be a racer.
The golden era, right?
It was a good time to be a racer, yeah.
Okay, the flash forward to the debut of the aluminum chassis on the CR250R. Was there ever a point when you had planned on racing it and were satisfied with it? Because, you know, Rich Taylor, longtime test rider with me and one of my best friends, he said the pre-production bikes they rode were actually good. And they liked them, they signed off on them, they went back to Japan, they came back all beefed up for durability and everything and didn't work the same. Did you get to ride the one that supposedly worked great?
No, you know, the misconception I think that everyone has about the ride, the pro riders, you know, they're not involved in the pre-production. They're not involved in like giving information back to, like if, you know, if anyone could just go like, hey, take my race bike back there and build that. It's not going to come back the same. And they're, first of all, they're not going to do that because what I like might be different from what you like. And then the next guy, they got to try and find some balance of what they got going on. And, you know, they never let us ride this stuff until the end. And, you know, even when I first rode the first 97, it was at Supercross. Honda had this private track out there and it was at Supercross and it was a hard pack track. And with hard pack, you don't really get the full feeling because there's no ruts, no bumps, no, like, it's just all smooth. So, like, you can ride anything on that. And I was like, oh, that's kind of cool, whatever, something new. I didn't think much of it. When I really understood that it was just, I mean, first of all, we went and tried to race it in Europe, had a hard time with it, couldn't ride it. Arm pump every night at Bercy, France. I finally won the third night after just wearing my body out so much that I finally couldn't even hold on, but I finally was relaxed enough to race.
Yeah.
Won one night, and the year before, I like probably won every night. So it was, you know, 97 or 90, that was the end of 96. I mean, I was killing everybody. And then all of a sudden, it was like I forgot how to ride. Went to Japan, Tokyo and Osaka, whatever, crashed, got some scars on my chin from that. It was sort of soft and muddy. I was like, what happened? What happened to me? And then we came home and we went testing at Glen Helen.
I was there that day.
Yeah. And that was when I was like, holy shit. Either I forgot how to ride completely or this thing's just so bad it just won't work.
Yeah.
And that was sort of the day, that was like the famous day that I called my dad in between sessions in the truck. I'm like, we're getting out. We got to do something different.
Yeah.
So that's when kind of all that stuff started to take place with Suzuki. And I mean, we literally had what, like 5 weeks?
Mm-hmm.
So it was pretty 12th hour kind of stuff. But
was the Suzuki chassis similar to the Hondas?
I feel like it was. I feel like it was. The Suzuki was really a good chassis once we got rid of those, whatever they call
conventional
those. Conventional forks. Conventional style forks that they were running over there.
Yeah.
We, you know, I got on the bike, tested with them, didn't have much time, raced with them. You know, LA Coliseum, that was documented where Lamson just took me out a couple times. Then was kind of, I think I was leading in Phoenix maybe or up front, went in the corner and the front just flexed out and I crashed.
Mm-hmm.
So then eventually we got the 94 or some of my 96 practice bike, just standard Honda forks.
Mm-hmm.
We put them on the Suzuki and then the whole thing changed.
Yeah.
Now granted, we had problems with the clutch a lot. But the chassis was really good. I mean, thank goodness for Wayne Henson because he came in and really helped us a lot. I had that one DNF Indianapolis, maybe it was that
flat
year.
Flat tire.
Well, I had a DNF too. The flat tire was one thing. I finished that race, which that was a kind of the nail that,
yeah,
you know,
I mean, I think had it not been for that flat, you could have still defended.
Could have still done it. But the one race in Indy when it took off the line and I went through corner one and my bike just wouldn't go anymore, that's like automatic 25 points down.
Mm-hmm.
So there was a few little instances that could have changed that whole situation. But, you know, I don't know. If I would have won the championship on the Suzuki, would I have been motivated to keep winning? I would have had to ride, you know, another year or two probably on the Suzuki, which I don't think the bike was quite ready for what it wasn't up to par is what it should be. I think it got them in gear and got them going and got sort of – you know, I just felt bad for like LaRocco and Albertine at that time because the thing was, I came off this super sick CR250 and then went onto that thing and I was like, well, all right, try to make it work.
I think it wasn't very powerful, right?
It wasn't very powerful.
Yeah, because I remember
got great starts because it never spun the wheel.
Yeah, we were riding in the track behind your parents' house, and I remember you're like, ride my bike, and I was like,
Yeah, they were pretty slow.
Yeah,
but it handled good. Chassis was good. Once we got the Honda forks on there, I mean, I was pretty frustrated. You know, it was a long Supercross season with lots of stuff going on, and when motocross came around, I was just like, whatever. Mm-hmm. I never really went practicing. I just raced because I didn't really. We didn't have anything to test, and there was just nothing. I was like, this is a whole completely different program. Anyways, that's when, you know, Dave Dameron and Shepard L came around, and Larry, and we started building that team. And, you know, that was really cool, right? Because at that time, like, Lusk left Yamaha, and you could see that Yamaha was, like, really good bike. So Lusk left Yamaha, went to Honda. And then I was like, oh, yeah, this is the bike. And that 98 Yamaha was a lot like the 96 CR. Mm-hmm. So it was very comfortable right away. We had to work on the angles of the forks and stuff like that, but to work on front traction. But, automatically I knew I had a good engine, good bike, good chassis. I just need to work on some personalized stuff with it. But I didn't honestly have a great, like, European season on the Yamaha, because that's when I first started riding it. I really didn't have that great. We didn't have it figured out at that point. I couldn't ride a stock one because it just, the front head angle was so different. So it took me some time. I mean, that was the winter that, like, Budden was killing it. He was out there, like, winning all these European races, and I was getting smoked, really. But I knew we had a good something we could work with. So anyways, we got it dialed in.
Yeah, that was a crazy time. Remember, you didn't know where you were going to go. So we had a Honda, a Cowie, and a Suzuki Niyama, all with number twos on it. We did knack-knack photos at your house for the next cover.
Oh, yeah. And that was
when you ended up doing the Chaparral thing, we cut Chaparral stickers out and put it on the...
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. I mean, there was really... I'm just really thankful because there was really no options, right? I mean, luckily Dave came into the game and Chaparral was doing really well, and he had that kind of that little team for a while that he was done messing around with, and he's like, I got a bunch of these squids, they got to go.
It's like Deegan and Brooks and
Schnell and Dave's probably like, what is this? We got to get rid of this and get a real guy. Luckily, it was just good timing for me. So, and Larry was, you know, Larry was great. He was so fun as a manager. We had a good synergy with that team. And
yeah,
we did a lot of winning. It's good.
That was a fun time in your career. Like, a lot of fun things happened. Like, even remember the Yamaha win ads where they made you into Austin Powers and stuff. You always been such a good sport about stuff like that.
I mean, the Yamaha ad agency. I mean, look, the ads don't happen if you don't win the races, right? So we won. Yeah. We did our part, but man. That's when the movie business was killer.
Yeah.
Right? So Austin Powers, we did Braveheart. We called it Raceheart.
Yeah.
We did Forrest Gump, Farthest Jump.
Yeah.
You know, who else was there? There was so many. We did Tombstone. Remember?
Remember that? Yeah.
Me, Dowd, Wyndham. Henry was there too.
Was there ever an ad concept proposal that you were like, yeah, no?
I mean, you guys, you know me, dude. Like, I was always up to be different.
Yeah.
I mean, I was always...
I mean, that's what I mean, the Austin Powers teeth.
No.
And I was like, dude, Jeremy did that. That's right.
Yeah. Nothing fazed me. I think I would have been maybe a little more insecure about that stuff if I wasn't able to win races. If they put you in those positions and you're not able to back that shit up, you know, I don't... I would be a little more scared probably to do that. But I'm totally fine making fun of myself when I can back it up.
Yeah. I think, what is your favorite ad type photo shoot or something that you did? Because mine for you is the Troy Lee catalog when you're in the boxing ring.
Well, I was really in shape in that one. That was pretty cool. Yeah, that was a really cool ad. And I have that in my hallway at home. Mm-hmm. I think one that stands out, and a lot of people ask me about it, is the 1-800-COLLECT phone commercial with Alyssa Milano.
We talked about that.
So, you know, everyone, it's funny, like, we were all in love with her, right? Because what was that?
Who's the boss?
The boss, right? Yeah. So it was Tony Danza and Alyssa Milano and all that. And then when I finally met her, and we did that shoot together, like, she smoked cigarettes and did not look like what I thought she looked like. So the whole thing was like, whoa. I was kind of disappointed. Like, the moto chicks that were around were like way hotter than her.
Yeah. And so then you said, like, she was kind of a bitch, right?
She was kind of, she was super stuffy, you know? And so I didn't really, it sucks. You know, they always say you never meet your heroes. You don't want to meet your heroes, yeah, or you don't want to meet people you like, 'cause you're just afraid of them being jack offs. Right.
Yeah.
And, she didn't impress me. Let's just say that. So, but it's one of the ones that stood out, right? Because, like, she was super famous.
Mm-hmm.
And I was not really famous at that time. And Supercross was small. And maybe at the end, I was a little more recognizable, maybe. But, yeah, those times were so fun because, I mean, I was a kid. We were growing up, you know?
Mm-hmm. Like, in the old shop, right? The first shop, you had all the stuff. You had the Peak Honda up on top and... But you had a pinball machine and you have a soda machine, like, with you on it. I mean,
it's pretty unheard of. You know, I think, you know, I didn't recognize, and I do fully now, that having a PR person, like, I had Cheryl Lynch work with me for a long time. And, you know, there's times when you go, like, what am I doing with a PR person and all this stuff? But, you know, in those times, we were always trying to figure out how to be different, how to get the different sponsors, how to get the different opportunities, and the importance of, I didn't recognize the importance of having a PR manager, right?
Mm-hmm.
But man, I sure do now. I miss those days. So cool. Pinball game, Coke machine, you know, video games at that time, right? There was no video games until mine came out. So the
toys.
Toys, yeah, Mattel was great. We had a long relationship with them. Yeah, just a lot of that stuff was so, so fun. It's funny that Dave Arnold texted me yesterday. He was my team manager for Honda in the 90s. And he texted me a picture of that pinball game.
Really?
He's like, hey, Jeremy, look at this. So it was pretty cool. It's good to hear from him. But yeah, looking back on that stuff's really, you don't recognize that when you're going through it, right? Mm-hmm. But I think, honestly, Supercross is bigger now, but it's certainly more boring.
Yeah, there's not the flash and flare and the personalities, and
you don't see riders, I think, trying to grow their personal brand.
Yeah.
You know? I don't know. Maybe I was just different.
All right, we're going to take one more quick break to hear from our sponsors. Back for more. Everyone, welcome back to the SML show presented by OGIO Power Sports and Yamaha Motors. You had Bud Light as a sponsor. Was that a Cheryl Lynch thing?
No. That was a Scott Sipkovic thing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Hollywood got that.
Dude, what was that like, dude? I mean,
massive. It's iconic, right? I mean, no one's ever had a sponsor that's that big.
Yeah.
you know, it's the way that started was, is I was going to have my own team. I was leaving, well, it was still supported by Chaparral a little bit, but I was going to get my own semi and get my own team. And what happened with that is, you know, back in the day when you used to go get sponsors, you used to make these decks with pictures of how it would all look, and you send them out, and you just basically you shoot out like 100 of these things and you try to get these meetings with people. And it worked. We got this meeting with Anheuser-Busch, a guy named Tim Schuler and Tony Sizemore, these guys that were, you know, friends of mine after the fact when we got this deal going. But, you know, Anheuser-Busch was coming out with a drink called 180 Energy Drink. Basically, it was an energy drink because it was kind of the start of the craze of the energy drinks.
Yeah.
And so it was 180, and it was yellow and blue. It worked really good with Yamahas. And it was like, wow, all right, this is cool. It's going to work out. And then like literally a week before the series started, he called Scott and he's like, we're pulling it. We're not doing it. We're not doing the 180 energy drink. We're not going to,
oh, they're not going to,
not going to make it. The drink. And you know, that was $1 million deal.
Yeah.
That was like, your heart just drops to the floor because you were counting on this, right? Deal's done, all this stuff. Well, thank goodness they beat it around up there, had some meetings about it, and they, you know, there was, you know, many brands they could choose from, but they chose us, put us on Bud Light. And, yeah, it worked out because Yamaha was blue and Bud Light was blue, and it just, it kind of all worked out. And it felt more prestigious, actually, the way it worked out. So it wasn't, but in the beginning, I'm not sure how many people know that, but it wasn't really supposed to be Bud Light. It was going to be 180, this drink called 180.
I remember when you got it, I'm all, dude, for real? And you're like, ah, I like Coors Light better, but yeah, Bud Light's my sponsor.
Yeah, we gave away all the Bud Light. We drank Coors Light.
Question.
Yeah.
Would you be pumped to be sponsored by them right now?
I'm going to have to go with a no on that.
Times have changed.
Yeah.
For sure.
Anheuser-Busch owned the company then. Now it's owned by a company called InBev, which is a giant conglomerate out of, I think, Germany or something. So different company now. What I did love is the guys that were working there. They were super cool. I still stay in touch with Tony, and those guys were fun. We had a good time. And one of the things I'll always be thankful for is Bud Light, and Anheuser-Busch paid for all the alcohol at my wedding.
Really?
So not only did they sponsor my team, they flowed all the drinks wedding for that big party we had at my wedding. So
nice.
That will never go underestimated. That was cool.
Yeah. I remember, you know, there was Bud Light gear, and I think
Thor,
Adobe was printing graphics, right?
Oh, yeah.
He told me the Bud Light kits was like printing money. Like he
too sold bad I didn't get any of that.
He sold the most of them for quads.
Oh, and it's funny,
with
right?
the way things these days are so crazy with licensing.
Right.
It's amazing to me that he got licensing to do all those different
things. I'm not sure you needed it then. I mean, people were just going for it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. These days, man, people get cease and desist letters left and right for everything.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it's like I said, it's a different world. I mean, It's a totally different world. I think people were not afraid to just go out there. I mean, think about Steel Roots. We were making movies back in the day. Krusty's, all these crazy movies back in the day. I'm not sure how much we did music license for Steel Roots, but we had, you know, like Danzig, and we had like Social D. Yeah. We had like bands that were big. Three Doors Down we had. When you could get a music license that didn't cost a whole lot.
Yeah.
Now I think it's a totally different
completely
deal.
Different game.
Yeah, completely
different. No, I mean, even you can't even make a video and put it on your Instagram.
Right.
You get flagged.
Yeah, you get flagged. So, you know, just as everything in the world's become more serious, more corporate, you know, more eyeballs on it, everything's more accessible now. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not sure we would have got away with some of that stuff when we were.
Yeah, it's funny because you mentioned the Steel Roots soundtrack. When we made our first movie at Transworld, the Kickstarter movie, we had a licensing woman, and I was like, right. Hey, I want to get Motley Crue, Kickstart My Heart. And
good
I think
luck.
I think my overall music licensing budget for the movie was $15,000, and they wanted $25,000 for the one song. And I'm all, how the hell did Jeremy put out Steel Roots with all that good music?
We used bands that weren't, I mean, we used the bands that weren't very big. I mean, Three Doors Down at that time was a pretty big band later, but it wasn't when we used it.
Yeah.
And then we used a lot of punk bands, and we had a lot of friends in the business, really. So that's kind of how that worked.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we were always scared to get sued.
Yeah.
I was, for sure. I'm like, dude, we better do this right. And so we had a music license person also. So it did cost some money, but it was worth it because, as you know, all those moto movies, like, basically, when you hear a, you know, one of those soundtracks or a
you think of a scene or a
scene in a movie, exactly. You think of, like, hear a song like that, you're like, oh, I'm picturing myself endoing in the dunes right now or whatever, mm-hmm. you know, so.
Yeah.
Different times.
Aside, like, we're talking about things like the movies and stuff, so take away all the racing, take away all the championships. What's something you did or accomplished or produced that you're most proud of that doesn't involve results?
I don't know. I was lucky enough to be good enough, I guess, and at the time to do a lot of firsts, right? I was first at a lot of stuff in our sport.
Mm-hmm.
You know, private team, big sponsor, you know, Supercross only, video game.
Alyssa Milano commercial.
Alyssa Milano commercial. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, it's an accumulation of stuff. I'm not sure there's one particular thing that stands out. I'm so stoked on the sport. I'm passionate about it. I still love it a lot to this day. As I've said many times before, it's created a life for me that I never imagined I'd ever have. Mm-hmm. So, it's just cool. It's just like, I'm lucky. I'm really lucky, and I continue to be lucky, and I just love it so much. But I think that shows, you know, that's why I'm in it. That's why I've been in it for a long time and still sort of try to, you know, I can adapt to any situation and, mm-hmm. and, you know, it's cool. I'm in a position where I can be as involved or as not involved as I want.
Yeah.
And that's a pretty, pretty good feeling.
But see, I mean, think about it. You're 50 now, right?
51.
51. Okay. You are so relevant to the sport still, to everyone, even the young kids, right? How many other guys that are even in their 40s are still as relevant as you are? And I think that's speaks to the way you represented the sport, the way you won everything, but mostly you stayed the same person the whole time.
Well, I think, you know, again, I think it's the winning part's good, but it's really just it's a reflection of the relationships that I built along the way, right? Mm-hmm. I'm still well respected by all the high ups in the companies because I always had good relationships with them all. Never had an agent really that was do any speaking for myself. I always was there and doing the speaking. You know, those kind of things go a long way. And I think, you know, thank goodness for Science Supercross at Kawasaki. I mean, we have so much fun with that thing.
Yeah.
And it's taken on a life of its own. And we shoot these episodes and it's just been really, really fun. And that's created a whole nother avenue for my own brand to stay out there. And there's kids that watch that probably don't even know I rode bikes, but
it's that Science guy,
you know, and I just have to say thanks to all the dads out there. Right. Cause the dads go, oh, this guy was the guy and their kids are into it. And I still get that today. I mean, when I was at the track today, kids were coming up and, you know, the kids wouldn't know unless their dads told them or their moms, you know, or whatever. And it's, you know, of course, when you have access to some of the old stuff, you can go out and watch. I mean, you know how it is. You can get on YouTube and get in a rabbit hole and just start watching old stuff. And I'm sure that's what the kids do today. But I'm not sure exactly why it's stayed so relevant. I mean, I've stayed very close to the sport. I still ride. I still do all the things, work with the good companies that I'm involved with. And it's a blessing, really. It's a blessing. But Trust me, I thought I'd be fully retired by now. But I'm not. And that's a great thing.
You got a busy schedule.
Yeah.
Speaking of that, thank you for taking time out to come visit us today at our new place. Thank you again for giving us our start and being involved with this and having our back.
Yeah. No, it's good to be here. And it's been a while, so I'm happy to see the new place.
Yeah.
It's really, congrats on that. So to all you guys. And we're not far from my shop.
Yeah.
I'm always close by. You know that. So I'll be up here. You just let me know when.
Well, we'll probably have you on another show here pretty soon.
All right.
Guys, thanks for checking out the SML show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. We'll see you next time.